Hi everyone, thanks for joining us tonight. My name is Jessica. I'm the librarian at the Chelmsford Library, or a librarian at the Chelmsford Library, not the library. We have a few. And we'll get started in just another minute. We'll let people come into the meeting. But while people are coming in, I'm just gonna share a couple of upcoming presentations that I will also email out to everybody tomorrow. Coming up on Sunday, April 3rd, we have the Blackstone Valley Veggie Gardens is coming back for a presentation at 2 p.m. on your backyard orchard. So that's growing fruit trees in your own backyard. And then on Monday, April 4th, a new time for our presentations, we have a virtual Turner's Modern World, a presentation on the art and times of J.M.W. Turner based on the current exhibition at the Museum of Fine Arts. And then on Thursday, we have the first of our One Book Chelmsford series of presentations leading up to a virtual visit by Ocean Vuong. So on Thursday, April 7th, we have a writing workshop called Family, Memory, and Place. A professor from New England College will come online and teach you how to write your family story. And finally, we have another compelling questions coming up on Friday, April 8th at 1 p.m. And that's Will Humans Achieve Interstellar Travel? And I believe that's being led by a member of the team at the Museum of Science. All of those are virtual. And again, I will send a reminder out tomorrow to everybody. But tonight, it may be more timely if it was before the Oscars, but you know, it's always timely to talk about movies. We have a virtual presentation on Sidney Poitier. So Frank Mandosa is joining us online, and he's a lifelong lover of cinema, high school English and film teacher, and he hosts talks on a wide variety of film topics. He also hosts a movie podcast called Silver Screeners and co-hosts Real Life, R-E-E-L, Life, for Stoughton Media Access Center. He has a Facebook group called Silver Screeners, and he has a Twitter and an Instagram name here that I will share in the chat so you can find him online as well. Tonight, he's gonna talk about Sidney Poitier, the man, the artist, and the reluctant hero. The holding the distinction of being the first African-American actor to receive the coveted Academy Award for Best Actor, Poitier has worked steadily in the show business industry for decades. His on-screen characters have inspired and galvanized movie fans around the globe. But underneath the critical praise and the box office power lies a man who felt conflicted and frustrated with the scripts he was given and the type of character that the studios repeatedly expected him to portray. A look at the life and career of the Broadway and cinematic star. So thank you so much, Frank Mandosa, for coming online with us tonight. And hopefully we'll have you back again soon.
Yeah, that'd be great. And thank you. Thank you to Jessica. Thank you to the Chelmsford Public Library and to everybody tuning in tonight. As Jessica just said, my name is Frank Mandosa. Name is right there on the screen on the left. But more importantly is the name above the image, Sidney Poitier. And the reason why I have the subtitle, The Man, the Artist, the Reluctant Hero, is because this was an actor who, as was just said, underneath all of the accolades and underneath the fame and the praise and the glory, was a very frustrated artist. So without getting too ahead of ourselves, that's the meaning behind this subtitle. So you'll also notice that on the right-hand side, it says number those index cards 1 through 5. I'm not expecting that you all have an index card necessarily, but if you happen to have a scrap piece of paper on you, I have 5 different trivia questions that I'll be asking throughout the presentation. And then I'll give the answer to each question. I'll allow maybe 10, 20 seconds, and then I'll give the answer to each one as well. I just like to make this as interactive as it can be, just to make you feel involved so that it's not just me talking nonstop for an hour or so without having any regard for the fact that there are people out there. So with that said, again, as Jessica just said, a little bit of shameless self-promotion. My Facebook film group is called Silver Screeners, and it is a public group. So do feel free to spread the word far and wide. Word of mouth always helps. I post all things movie related, past, present, and future, ranging from information about upcoming podcast episodes to upcoming talks, both virtual and in person, as well as fun movie trivia. For example, this morning I posted that today, on this date, in 1999, the teen comedy 10 Things I Hate About You was released on today's date. And usually when I offer an on this day kind of a post, I usually offer a fun fact to go along with the film in question. So Facebook film group is Silver Screeners. I usually post the exact same information to Twitter and to Instagram, as you can see here, FilmBuff 1974, Frank Mandosa 1974. Now you all know how old I am. And the email ID that you see, feel free to use this email at any time. It's not my personal email. It's a special Gmail account that I created for these film talks and for my podcast. So feel free to email silverscreenerspod@gmail.com at any time with any movie questions, or if you just want to say hi, or really anything at all movie related. I'm always happy to interact with fellow film buffs. And the podcast shares the same name as the Facebook film group, Silver Screeners. So enough of the commercial. Let's dive into why you came here tonight. So Sidney Poitier, let's dive right into the first trivia question. What state would you say he was born in? Was it Louisiana, Florida, Alabama, or none of the above, because wasn't he born in the Bahamas? I'll give you about 10 seconds or so, and then I'll give you the answer. And the correct answer is he was born in Florida. B. He was born in Florida. He was born in the United States. And I'll explain that, because he was raised in the Bahamas. So let me give you the little bit of a background. He was born on February 20th, 1927. Now, his parents were rather poor. They were farmers, specifically produce, tomatoes. And so the two of them, both of his parents, they were in Florida for the purposes of selling produce. And at the time, his mother was 2 months pregnant with him. And he was born 7 months premature. So they were, of course, very, there did not seem to be much hope that this infant would survive. He was born weighing less than 3 pounds. These are his parents right here, Reginald James and Evelyn. So they lived, all of his older siblings and his parents, they all lived in the Bahamas in Cat Island. So yes, he is Bahamian, but the reason why, he was born in Florida, the reason why they were in Florida, I mean, she was only 2 months pregnant, so she would have no reason to think that, you know, anything would happen at this point. So it was simply a business trip. So as I said, his father was a tomato farmer, and I got this quote from People magazine back in January when he passed away. I was not aware of this until I saw this in the article on him, and said, and I use asterisk where appropriate, his father, unsure of the baby's chances, went out to buy an infant's casket from a segregated funeral home and returned with a shoebox. And I just find that completely mind-blowing in terms of, you know, just in terms of, you know, what Sidney Poitier eventually would go on to become in terms of, just in terms of name recognition. So about 3 months of recovery. Now his mother, as any parent would be, was, you know, really upset. You know, she really was hoping that her baby would survive. She did go to see a fortune teller. And as unbelievable as it may seem, the fortune teller said to his mother, and I quote, "He will survive. Don't worry about your son. He will survive. He will not be sickly. He will travel to most corners of the earth. He will be rich and famous. Your name will be carried all over the world." Now, here we are, March 31st, 2022, and we're all here tonight talking about this man. So funny how things work out. Whoever this fortune teller was, she, at the absolute least, said all of the right things. So I have here also a map of the whole region, Nassau and Cat Island, you know, San Salvador. So that's just to give you a visual of where he spent his childhood years. By the time he was 12 years old, Sidney saw his first film. It was a Western. And there he was sitting in the audience and he was watching this American film and he was completely captivated by it. And he knew at the age of 12, at that point in time, he said to himself, someday I am going to be up there on the silver screen. His goal was to go to Hollywood and to become an actor. 12 years old, that from seeing a Western. Needless to say, as is the case with most aspiring actors, it was not an overnight success. By January of 1943, he was 1 month shy of turning 16. So he was still 15, but a month away from turning 16, when he left the Bahamas behind, he left Cat Island behind, he was sent to live with his brother in Florida. And he was a bit of a, he got into some, I'll use the word mischief, I'll use the word rascally behavior, nothing serious, nothing criminal, just, you know, he was finding himself. He did have in Florida, I should mention, when he was in Florida, he did have his first encounter with the KKK, and that was his first exposure to racially motivated hostility and violence. So he moved to New York City eventually with only $3 in his pocket. And with $3 in his pocket, he took whatever odd job he could find, washing dishes in the kitchens of restaurants, things like that. He just did whatever work he could find, basically just to survive. There were times when things were so bleak and so desperate, he would be sleeping in the men's room of bus terminals or bus station bathrooms. He basically lived the life of someone who was literally struggling to survive on the streets. So he was at this point about 16, 17 years old, maybe 18 years old. So I think about where I was between the ages of 16 and 18, and there, but for the grace of God, go I, didn't have to deal with this kind of, with these kinds of obstacles. But what he did do was eventually he did join the army. So here's a photo of him in 1943. This is him. This is an army photo of Sidney Poitier. Now, he was in there for a little bit, not for an incredibly long time. By the time he was honorably discharged, it was 1945. And in 1945, he decided to set his sights. He renewed himself to his goal of becoming a professional actor. So living in New York City, he figured, okay, maybe the stage is where I should be. Maybe the stage is where to get my foot in the door. So after several attempts, he was not accepted right away, but after several attempts, he was accepted into what was called the American Negro Theater. And interestingly enough, another new face in this theater, someone who joined around the same time that he did, none other than Harry Belafonte. This is where they first met and formed a lifelong friendship. They remained friends until Mr. Poitier's death a couple of months ago. By October of 1946, he finally made his Broadway debut. Now he had done some stage productions for the American Negro Theater, for ANT, but as far as his debut on the Great White Way, the Broadway stage, it was October of 46. And it was an all-Black production of the Greek play Lysistrata. Now, I remember reading Lysistrata. I remember having to read Lysistrata when I was in college. And it's a sort of a Greek, it's serial comic. It's a Greek play that definitely has elements of comedy in it. It's actually rather risque. There's a lot of innuendo in it, much more than you would think. And my point is I would have loved to have seen him in this because I bet it would have been a fascinating night at the theater. So this was October of 46 when he made his Broadway debut. And that brings me to the next question I have for you. This one's a true or false question. On opening night, he was paralyzed with stage fright. He forgot his lines and the show only lasted 4 performances. Now, I'm not saying that the show only lasted 4 performances because of him, but the show itself was basically a bust. So I'll give it a few seconds and then I'll tell you the answer. And the correct answer is true. This is true. His Broadway debut was, shall we say, less than auspicious. He did forget his lines. He was gripped with stage fright. As he described it, it was Broadway and it was primarily a white audience. And I'm not saying that he was intimidated by the fact, but, you know, by the racial factor, but he was intimidated by the fact that, you know, this is his Broadway debut. And, you know, he felt very much both in and out of his element, if that makes any sense. I mean, he felt he was where he's supposed to be, you know, acting on stage, but, you know, he was just gripped with the sense of, oh my God, this is it. And the show was canceled after only four performances. So he and Harry Belafonte found themselves on the unemployment line. And this is where things get interesting, because these are things that are not necessarily commonly known, not out there for mass consumption very much. He and Harry Belafonte decided that together, what they should do is put together a nightclub comedy routine. They tried their hand at performing comedy routines, comedy sketches in nightclubs, and that was, unfortunately, a miserable failure. Well, unfortunately, in the sense that at the time, I'm sure it was very crushing for them, but fortunately for us, because he became a Hollywood superstar, and who knows what might have been had it turned out differently. So they did try their hand at comedy, but even he himself said, I'm not an inherently funny person. He said, I'm just not funny. He said, so it was really an idea that was doomed from the word go. They also tried, believe it or not, they tried their hand at business entrepreneurship. They wanted to come up with a protein-filled bodybuilding drink, but they could not get the FDA approval. So that went bust as well. They remained on the unemployment lines together. And because they were such devoted friends, they shared their checks with each other. So it's nice to have someone that you're that close with. Then just to fast forward a little bit here to, you know, to bring us into his, you know, his beginnings with show business. It was a chance encounter he had one evening with an agent who liked what he saw. The agent liked what he saw. Now, at the same time, he was struggling to get a screen test for the big movie studios in Hollywood. And he actually landed an audition with 20th Century Fox. But here's the thing. On the night before his scheduled audition for 20th Century Fox, this agent that he randomly met turned to him and said to him, no need to audition. I'm offering you a lead in a Broadway production. Problem was that he would have to decide now, do I stay with my scheduled 20th Century Fox audition, which is not necessarily a sure thing, or do I accept this lead, this offer of a lead, which is being handed to me on a silver platter? No need to audition, no competition. The role is mine if I want it. So that's a pretty tough call. Do I go with the sure thing, which would keep me here in New York, or do I stick with a scheduled audition in the hopes that it will lead to something a bit more widespread, shall we say, you know, more, you know, greater exposure? What he ultimately decided to do was go to the audition for 20th Century Fox. He turned down the offer of the Broadway lead. And that led to his being cast in his film debut, 1950's No Way Out. In this film, he plays a medical doctor in a hospital, which was, for 1950, was very progressive. It was very progressive to have that. So here he is playing this doctor. Richard Widmark, the famous Richard Widmark, he plays his patient, who also happens to be a criminal, a wounded criminal. And not only is he a wounded criminal, but Richard Widmark's character, if you're familiar with Widmark's work, then this probably won't be a surprise. Widmark's character is a bit of a nasty guy. He says vile and racist things to the Poitier character. And you know, there's a love interest for the Widmark character. This is 1950. So even though Poitier is front and center and is in most of the scenes and is the lead actor, he was billed fourth. I'm going to show you the trailer in just a second, the original trailer. And as you'll see in a moment, Poitier, he's listed fourth in the credits. Widmark gets top billing, and then you have a couple of other actors. And then finally, we see Poitier's name. Little side note, Ruby Dee, the great actress Ruby Dee, his frequent co-star and his lifelong friend. This is the first time they worked together in this film. And she plays in this film his sister-in-law. So I'll show you the trailer now for No Way Out, and then we'll move forward from there.
Got killed instead of Johnny.
That's your favorite question, ain't it? Only the last time you asked it wasn't about being dead.
You scum.
It was why couldn't it be you I married to instead of Johnny?
You dirty scum.
Sounded good in the dark.
I should have killed you.
You had other things on your mind.
What is it, Dr. Brooks?
This man has stolen a scalpel. He's got it hidden on him. I want him searched.
Hand it over, Biddle.
I ain't got it, Doc.
Are you sure there's one missing?
I checked out three, Dr. Wharton. We've only found two.
He's had every opportunity to take it. Miss Blake and I had our backs to him most of the time. The scalpels were lying right here on the instrument table. And all he had to do was...
So as you may have noticed in the credit sequence of this trailer, you know, they also use some terminology that's dated to say the absolute least. But No Way Out is available on DVD. So if it's a movie that you've not seen, or if it's one you haven't seen in a while, it's one that I would recommend. I wouldn't call it my favorite of Poitier's films, but it was definitely, in my opinion, a good strong one to begin with in terms of the story and the quality of his acting, and again, how progressive it was for 1950. Now, with that said, it got a lot of good reviews, and it did get an Academy Award nomination for Best Screenplay. Unfortunately, though, in terms of box office success, that really was not the case. It wasn't really a hit, and as a result, it didn't lead to a lot of great film office form at first. The themes of racism and the idea of an African-American man as a doctor and being the voice of morality and reason, that was still something that a lot of people, maybe I shouldn't say a lot of people, but I will say pockets of people throughout the country, it's not something that they were ready for yet. And it was a film that was banned in some southern states, and even right here in Massachusetts. I don't understand this. Maybe one of you can explain it, but this movie right here in Massachusetts was not allowed to be screened on Sundays because of the fears of racial violence. So apparently the thinking was that kind of thing could only happen on Sunday. I'm not sure what it is. Maybe it's because it was a Sunday. For whatever reason, the film was not allowed here in Mass to be screened on Sundays. Because there were fears of the repercussions, you know, audience reactions getting volatile and potentially tumultuous. After No Way Out, the following year, he starred in a film adaptation of the novel Cry the Beloved Country. Again, very powerful story, but in terms of being palatable for, you know, for movie audiences, in terms of, you know, just in terms of entertainment and, you know, mass consumption of media, again, it was not a hit. You know, as I have here, a whimper. Rather than a bang, it was a whimper. So he now has two films under his belt, and neither one of them really made an impact with the public. This was also the same year that he met the woman who would become his first wife, Juanita Hardy, who was a dancer and a model. Here she is right here. Well, the two of them, here they both are. And that leads to the next trivia question. True or false, together he and Juanita had four sons. So I'll give them about 5-6 seconds. Give you a chance to think about it. And this might be an example of me kind of asking you a trick question. They did have four children together, but they were all daughters. So technically the question is false. Together he and Juanita had four daughters. But I want to fast forward to 1955, because if we're going to talk about his early screen appearances and the ones where he really began to be noticed, look no further than Blackboard Jungle. In Blackboard Jungle, this is 12 years before Two Sir with Love. He plays a student. He's 28 years old and he's playing a high school student. Years before Grease made that a thing, I guess, but he plays a high school student. And he is the troublemaker, the rebel, you know, the Judd Nelson, John Bender from the Breakfast Club of the Blackboard Jungle. Glenn Ford is the teacher in question. And Poitier was singled out by the critics as giving a particularly effective performance. He was part of an ensemble. He was not a lead. He was not the lead. But part of that was the fact that he really delved into the psychology of the characters that he played. Maybe you're familiar with the term method acting. Method acting became a new way of acting around this time, the late 40s, going throughout the 50s. This was a time when we had the likes of Paul Newman, Montgomery Clift, Marlon Brando, James Dean, people who studied acting in New York City with the Actors Studio. And rather than learning how to be a glamorous movie star, instead learned how to de-glam if necessary, if the role called for it, and to really search within themselves for elements of the character that they're playing, to really feel the character. Now, I'm not taking anything away from the movie stars of the so-called golden age. I'm not taking anything away from the likes of Clark Gable or Vivian Leigh or Jimmy Stewart or, you know, early Cary Grant, early Katharine Hepburn, people like that. You know, all fine actors, don't get me wrong, but it was a different style of acting. You take a look at any classic film from the 30s and the 40s, they were glamorized. You know, they were glamorized. Now, maybe they played farmers, like in How Green Was My Valley, or maybe they played, you know, I mean, I'm not saying that they were all, you know, dressed to the nines in every scene they did, but there certainly was a sense of stylized mess. Like, even when you think about Vivian Leigh in Gone with the Wind, scenes where she has dirt in her face, her hair is always very fashionably tussled. It doesn't look unkempt. It looks deliberately arranged. You can tell it was styled to look tussled, if you know what I'm saying. All of that was out the window with method acting. With method acting, it was no, we're going for grounded realism. And Poitier was very much part of that new movement, along with Dean and Brando and Newman and Clift and all of them. So he brought that to this performance in Blackboard Jungle. Now, around this time, as I said, he and Juanita, they were beginning a family. And he was asked, he was beginning to be asked, you know, who is this actor? You know, we've seen him. So he was beginning to get noticed. And for better or worse, it was 1955 when Blackboard Jungle came out. So this would have been the same year as the Montgomery bus boycott, when the civil rights movement was beginning to pick up steam, you know, Rosa Parks. And so with all of that going on around the country, he found himself, and this is where the subtitle of tonight's program, The Reluctant Hero, comes into play. He found himself being asked a lot when he was doing press for his films. he found himself being asked for his political opinions. You know, he was expected to be the spokesperson, if you will, for lack of a better way of putting it. And he said to Newsweek, he said, quote, "I have no politics. I try to do and say nothing that might be a step backward." So at first he tried to, you know, keep a low profile as far as that goes. When asked about his marriage, which was beginning to show signs of strain, he said, and again, I quote, he said, "I'm a patriarchal kind of man. I happen to believe that the man should be the head of a household, make the decisions, and have the respect of his family." So there were conflicting parenting styles between him and his wife. As far as his, on the professional side of his life, as far as things were going, the very first time that he finally got co-star billing was in a 1957 movie called Edge of the City. Not only was this his first time being billed as a co-star of the film, this was also his first awards recognition. He was given a nomination for a BAFTA, which is the British version of the Academy Awards. So he was nominated for a BAFTA for Best Foreign Actor. Again, co-star and friend Ruby Dee, they reteamed. She previously played a sister-in-law in No Way Out. Now she's playing his wife. And he's pictured here with John Cassavetes. John Cassavetes, who would go on to do movies like The Dirty Dozen and Rosemary's Baby. He would marry Jenna Rollins, in fact, and they would make some films together. Edge of the City is available on Amazon streaming as well as DVD. And he plays plays a blue collar worker, a union man, and he's well-liked, he's a foreman. And John Cassavetes plays an army deserter who is trying to basically keep a low profile, finds a job working with him, and they form a friendship. And then racism rears its ugly head. Another foreman who is bigoted, prejudiced, begins to make some waves, and then the story sort of goes on from there. I don't want to give away too much. All I'll say is that Poitier and Ruby Dee in this film, their characters are married, and they set John Cassavetes up with someone they know. So you do have the love interest piece of a story as well, which from this time period was fairly typical. But here's where things for him got a little controversial. In his professional life, things getting a little controversial. The studios were looking, specifically MGM, Samuel Goldwyn, the G of MGM, was putting together a film version of this stage musical. Now, it's extremely dated, and there are certainly some problematic and some cringeworthy elements of the story and of the characters. And it was not, even then, even in the 50s, this was not a film that he felt comfortable doing. So he never committed to it. His agent, or so the story goes, his agent's associate apparently turned to Sam Goldwyn and said, okay, he'll do it. So Goldwyn had a verbal promise from Poitier's management. Harry Belafonte was offered the role first, but declined, finding it degrading. So Poitier is now verbally promised to be in this film without his knowledge. And he, in the meantime, is showing interest in a script that he really wants to do with Stanley Kramer, director Stanley Kramer, The Defiant Ones, which I'll talk more about in a bit. Well, Sam Goldwyn said, oh no, I have a promise from your team that you're doing this movie. And Poitier said, I never agreed to that. And Goldwyn said, well, guess what? I mean, we have you under contract. So if you want to do Defiant Ones, you know, here's the ultimatum. You either do both of these movies or I'm not letting you do either one. So he wanted to do the Defiant Ones very much. So he agreed to do both. It was something he never really felt completely resolved with. And I have here a quote from a biography that I read on him. Friends and associates expressed disappointment. Disappointment that he would play this kind of a role in this kind of a film. When Poitier explained his decision to Belafonte, he listened, but he never accepted the rationale. Because don't forget, as it says up top, Belafonte had turned down the role, finding it insulting. He went on to do The Defiant Ones. And if you have not seen The Defiant Ones, or if you have not seen it in a while, this is definitely one to put on your must-see list. It is fantastic. He and Tony Curtis, they play runaways from jail, and they're handcuffed together. And I really don't want to say too much and give anything else away. The premise of the film is that they're handcuffed together, whether they like it or not. They have no key, of course. And I'll leave it at that. But I will say that The Defiant Ones did receive the Silver Bear Award at the Berlin Film Festival, an award that Eleanor Roosevelt personally presented afterwards at her home in New York. I'll play for you right now the trailer for The Defiant Ones, which will give you a little bit more information than I'm giving.
Go on, tell me all that big talk about Johnny Potatoes when the chain's off and nobody chasing you.
Come on. You can't, can you? You can't because you're nothing. You're not even a man. You're a monkey on a stick. That cracker mob back there, they pulled the string and you jumped. I'm a strange colored man in a white South town. How long you think before they pick me up?
Get off my back. I ain't married to you now. What do I care? Come on.
You married to me, all right, Joker. And here's the ring. But I ain't going south on no honeymoon now. We going north. Time's gonna come, Joe. The time's gonna come.
Go on, burn their eyes out.
Can't go lynching me. I'm a white man.
I'll tell you the kind of white man you are.
And I'll be Charlie Potatoes. Charlie Potatoes coming down the street.
No more yuzzer.
Now, you may have noticed that there was absolutely no music in that trailer, and that was a deliberate choice. That was a deliberate choice. The film is a pretty good example of what's called cinema verite, meaning authenticity, really. Authenticity, just a very realistic, not melodramatic portrayal of human nature, really. Now, the next question that I have for you is this: true or false, The Defiant Ones, in which he co-stars with Tony Curtis, this was the first ever Oscar nomination for a Black performer in film. And the correct answer to this is false, because the first acting win was Hattie McDaniel for Gone with the Wind. She received Best Supporting Actress for that one. And then James Baskett received a special recognition Oscar for his role as Uncle Remus in Song of the South. But as far as winning a competitive, and as far as being nominated competitively for an Academy Award, Sidney Poitier was the first African-American man, and it was in the leading category. He was the first leading actor, the first leading performer in film. And that brings us to 1959 and a playwright by the name of Lorraine Hansberry and a groundbreaking play called A Raisin in the Sun. He plays in this, well, in the stage production, he began on Broadway first. He and Ruby Dee and he play husband and wife. A Raised in the Sun is the story of a family living in Chicago's South Side, and it's the 1950s. And basically it's the story of a family that has a dream of leaving behind this dreary apartment, this life of weariness, and owning their own home out in the suburbs. And as the play begins, his character's father has recently passed away, and the family is waiting for a life insurance check to arrive in the mail. And his mother's plan is to use part of the money for a down payment for a new home. However, he has different ideas of what to do with the money. He does not want to buy a house. Instead, he's hoping to be able to use the money to open up his own business. He's a limo driver, and it's a life that he finds very unfulfilling and embarrassing. He does not feel that it gives him any sense of pride. He's tired of driving around this rich businessman and basically watching this guy who's younger than he is go and have these important business lunch meetings. And while he's sitting outside in the car, he looks in through the window of the restaurant and he sees the life that he desperately yearns to be part of. He's hungry. He's hungry for more living out of life than what was allowed for people of his stature at the time. So then there's much more to the story than just that. But again, I'm avoiding spoilers. The play was the very first play to be produced by an African-American on stage, on the Broadway stage. It was the first play written by a Black woman, and it won the New York Circle Critic Award for Best Play of 1959. As far as the Tonys go, it got a slew of nominations, including Best Actor for him. Didn't get it, but hey, a nomination's a nomination. But again, he found himself being asked questions about his political views. It's now 1959, and things are beginning to, they're heating up all the more in terms of the what's going on in the country. And he said, once again, I am not a crusader consciously. My goal is to spread just a little love, just a little understanding. But with that said, 4 years later, he was involved, admirably so, in the March on Washington, along with Harry Belafonte, Rita Moreno, Ruby Dee, Ossie Davis, Paul Newman, Charlton Heston. So he was part of the March on Washington. So I'm certainly not looking to have you all, leave this webinar at the end saying, gee, I never knew that he had no involvement in politics whatsoever. He did. I mean, he was involved in the match, but I don't know if he would have regarded that as something political. And based on what he has said and what his philosophies were, I think he saw that more as a human rights, as a humanitarian kind of a thing, not so much of a political thing, if you know what I mean. Either way, back to Raisin in the Sun. Tony nomination for Best Play, Tony nomination for Best Actor, standing room only crowds for months. And in 1961, most of the Broadway cast, including him, reunited for the film version. So once again, he and Ruby Dee are on screen together and they're playing husband and wife. And the film version, it didn't do terribly, it didn't do great, but it did okay. It was not nominated for any Oscars or anything like that. It certainly was not, the big smash film version of a Broadway play the way that, West Side Story would have been seen as, or the way that My Fair Lady or, films like that. But that does bring us to 1963, because this is the defining moment of his career. In 1963, Harry Belafonte, once again, turns down a role that he finds, quote, highly meaningless, end quote, and Sidney Poitier accepts the role instead. That role was in a film called Lilies of the Field. I don't know how Belafonte felt about it afterwards when Poitier became the first Best Leading Actor Oscar winner of color. But Poitier did not see it as anything that was really going to change much. He said, and I quote, did I say to myself, this country is waking up and beginning to recognize that certain changes are inevitable? No, I did not. My career was unique in all of Hollywood. I knew that I was a one-man show. So in other words, he knew that he was not paving the way for this to become more and more the norm. He knew that he was the exception. He didn't think that doors were being opened necessarily. Again, the subtitle of tonight's program, The Reluctant Hero, he felt very much that he was the token. He felt very much that he was the token, that he was the go-to actor anytime Hollywood wanted to make a movie that had the message that racism with a capital I is wrong with a capital W, as cynically as it was put. But well-intentioned films, but he just felt that the roles that he was asked to play, he just felt it was the same thing over and over again. I'm always playing the suffering in silence. I'm always playing the dignified, elegant, well-spoken, well-polished kind of character. As an actor, he found that very limiting. He found it very limiting because he, like any actor would, he wanted a role with depth rather than just playing the same personality over and over and over again. He wanted, he would turn to studios, can I have a character who loses his temper every once in a while? Can I have a character who perhaps is a bit unsavory? Can I play a villain? But he was just kept, they just kept casting him as the angelic, again, suffering in silence kind of character. But before we get too much more into that, I think it is important that we do take a look at his Oscar acceptance speech, the award presented to him by the great Anne Bancroft, who had won Best Actress the year before for The Miracle Worker.
Well, we're in the adrenaline section, this knee-knocking hour here, and I won't delay anymore to present the award for the Best Actor, the very brilliant Academy Award-winning actress of last year, Miss Anne Bancroft.
The nominees for the Best Performance by an Actor are Albert Finney in Tom Jones, Richard Harris in This Sporting Life, Rex Harrison in Cleopatra, Paul Newman in Her, Sidney Poitier in Lilies of the Field. The winner is Sidney Poitier in Lilies.
Because it is a long journey to this moment, I am naturally indebted to countless numbers of people, principally among whom are Ralph Nelson, James Poe, William Barrett, Martin Baum, and of course, the members of the Academy. For all of them, all I can say is a very special thank you.
So that was his Oscar acceptance speech. One film that I can offer to you as an example of one that really, for him, resulted in this frustration hitting its peak, A Patch of Blue. Ironically, it brought him his biggest box office success to date. But he began to question, am I an actor or am I a role model? Are people expecting me to act or are people expecting me to basically be the voice of, the voice of my community? And that was something that he found a little unfair. He found A Patch of Blue, the script for A Patch of Blue, to be, as he put it, very little relation to objective reality. I was at my wit's end. His frustration was reaching a peak. Now, this film is also noteworthy because he plays a character who befriends a young woman who is blind, as you can see here from the cover art, and pretty soon a romance blossoms. And there is a scene that involves an interracial kiss, which was cut in the South from all prints that played in the South, and it was eventually decades later reinstated for the DVD release. He met Katharine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy, two acting legends, for the film Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. And this is his description in his own memoirs in 2000. When he first met Katharine Hepburn, he said, "She looked at me and didn't say a word and didn't crack a smile. That's how big a step this was for her." These were good, enlightened, liberal people. These were major Hollywood stars putting their ideals to the test. I still think asking them to be any more liberated in the America that we knew at the time would have been expecting a hell of a lot too much. So he felt very much that she was sizing him up, but he did find them both, as he put it, to be both Hepburn and Tracy, to be both exceedingly decent people. The premise of the film is that their daughter, their only child, announces her intentions of marrying his character. And so it's a story of the reaction of her parents and his parents, and whether or not this is something they feel that they can get behind. Now, I do realize the time. I do have one clip that I do want to make sure we leave enough time for, so I'll skip this clip. It is available, however, on YouTube, so if you'd like to see it on YouTube, then you'll find it there, or you can always email me as well, and I'll happily send you the link. That way we leave enough time to mention the Best Picture winner In the Heat of the Night. If I had to single out my favorite Poitier films, I would say The Defiant Ones and The Heat of the Night. Personal opinion, but those are my two favorites. In the Heat of the Night is a crime thriller, a cop drama. It's also a study in racism. It's the story, he plays someone who is wrongly accused of murder. And when it turns out in the first 10 minutes of the film, not a spoiler, that he's actually a police officer, he's then asked to help them solve the murder. So he goes from being a suspect to the cop on the beat. Now, the movie takes place in a fictional town in Mississippi. It was filmed mostly above the Mason-Dixon line, but when they had to go down to Tennessee for a few outdoor scenes, that was something that he did not want to do, but he begrudgingly agreed. He slept with a pistol beneath his pillow because of death threats that the production was receiving. The film was banned in some southern states. It's probably most famous for two things. Number one, this is a scene where he is slapped by this white man and he slaps him back. So that was something that audiences had never seen before. And that was truly a trailblazing moment in the history of cinema. The second thing that this film is probably most remembered for is his famous line. He plays a character named Virgil Tibbs. And when racial slurs are used against him, mockingly, and when he's asked, "What do they call you?" his response is, "They call me Mr. Tibbs." And the director of the film said, "I'll never forget when the film was shown to a Black audience in New York. The audience went wild when he said that." 1967 really was the peak of his career. He continued working steadily, but unremarkably. And by the time the 70s rolled around, he returned to the character of Virgil Tibbs for two sequels to In the Heat of the Night. One of them was called They Called Me Mr. Tibbs. But by the 70s, as I said, his style was beginning to fade. He turned to Ruby Dee, and you can see for yourself what it was he actually said to her. His anger over the fact that he was still being asked for his political viewpoints. You know, what is this? People waiting for me, Sidney Poitier, to lead them out of the wilderness. I'm supposed to lead the charge. I'm supposed to speak for, you know, the entire race. And he just felt that that was really a ridiculous amount of pressure that he was feeling. He also found himself, I mean, if we're to speak strictly in terms of in show business terms, he was getting older. And unfortunately, to this day, Hollywood is like that. Once you reach a certain age, roles begin to dry up sometimes. Or at least the good roles begin to dry up. And there was also a new generation of actors, angrier actors, who were allowed to be angry on screen. Deacon Jones, Rosie Grier, O.J. Simpson. These were actors of color who played characters different from the kind of character that Poitier always played. And his type of character was beginning to be regarded as obsolete, really. So he took his career in a different direction. And which was it? Screenwriting, directing, songwriting, are on set catering? And the correct answer is directing. He turned to directing. And throughout the 1970s, he churned out steadily some comedies that were box office successes, though the critics had a field day tearing them to shreds. He also would, by the 90s, he would turn to television miniseries. He did a made-for-television sequel to Sir with Love in the mid-90s. He played Thurgood Marshall, he played Nelson Mandela. And by the time the 90s rolled around and actors like Denzel Washington and Danny Glover and Morgan Freeman and Eddie Murphy and Louis Gossett Jr., he was thrilled. He threw his arms up in the air and he said, and I quote, "It's like the cavalry coming to relieve the troops. Greater representation, it's not all on me," was his feeling. But his acting career began to slow down at that point. He wrote his memoir called The Measure of a Man. He won a Grammy for it, actually, for the audiobook recording. He got the Kennedy Center Honors. He received an Honorary Academy Award in 2001, a Lifetime Achievement Oscar in 2001. And as we all know, January 6th of this year, he passed away at the age of 94. And he did die at home, his Beverly Hills home. And to close out this presentation, I do have here a montage set to the song that we all know and love called To Sir With Love. So, To Sir With Love, 1967, that was his banner year. That was the year of Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, In the Heat of the Night, and this one. So it was a year that in show business circles, there tends to be a period where you really reach a peak. And for him, it was 67. So just to show you, I do have here my works cited slide in case you wanted to take a look at any of the biographies or any of the articles that I used when I was doing my research. His memoir is called The Measure of a Man, a spiritual autobiography. Mark Harris wrote a fantastic book called Pictures at a Revolution, Five Movies and the Birth of the New Hollywood. And the biography I read was Sidney Poitier, man, actor, icon. And then the People magazine that I referenced earlier. But I'll stop sharing my screen now. And that way, there we go. I'll bring back here. So now I can see all of the Zoom squares, and I'll go into the chat and I'll see if there are any questions that anybody may have. Let's see here. Oh, great, audio version of the memoir. The link to that is included. Excellent, thank you. As well as, are these the trailers? Yeah.
Hi, Frank, sorry. We're in a webinar, so we can't see all of the people in the room. But we had, I don't see any questions. What an amazing career though that was. It was, Debbie has a question. Did he ever say what movie he was most proud of?
That's a great question. And I'll be honest, I'm not gonna make up an answer. I will say that there were certainly movies that he felt fell short of what they could have been. But as far as movies that he felt particularly proud of, I can tell you that he felt that In the Heat of the Night was, he felt that In the Heat of the Night was certainly one of his strongest. I can also tell you that Guess Who's Coming to Dinner? I think that a lot of the progressive thinking that that movie was encouraging was sort of overshadowed by the death of Spencer Tracy. Spencer Tracy died only about 2 weeks after finishing filming his final scenes. So most of the publicity and the marketing surrounding the film, which was released later on that year, really wasn't centered so much on him, so much as it was on, you know, how do we market this film as, you know, Spencer Tracy's final film, and Katharine Hepburn, it was her real life niece who played their daughter in the film. So really the focus of most of the publicity went to Hepburn and Tracy and their legacy. So I do know that both he and Katharine Hepburn's niece, they both sort of felt sidelined by that one.
Did he feel any pressure by any of the political groups of the time period to have more of a voice, like outside of the film industry?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And that's what frustrated him. I can tell you, and this is a quote I remember from the book Pictures at a Revolution. He was doing press for In the Heat of the Night. And this would have been 1967. And reporters were asking him for his views on civil rights. And his response was, look, I'm an artist and you're asking me to comment on things that are not my field. You know, meaning he's not, you know, he's not in the field of politics. And his co-star in The Heat of the Night, Lee Grant, she defended him, saying to him, this is a terribly unfair burden to put on him. So yes, he definitely felt the pressure to be more of a spokesperson, but to give him, you know, to be fair to him, he also knew that he was, unfortunately for him, he had to tread carefully, really, because he knew that all of his successes could be taken away in a moment if just he said one wrong word came out. So I think for him it was erring on the side of caution more than anything else. Not a lack of interest, not a lack of conviction, more just erring on the side of caution for his career.
Yeah, and I guess Hollywood's also not what it is today. I mean, the news cycle isn't quite as quick to pick up on things. But yeah, I still probably had to be pretty careful about what he said. Let's see, we've got Karen is asking, do you know if any of his daughters are involved in filmmaking or industry or the arts?
Okay, I think one of his daughters, I do think one of his daughters is, and I'm not sure if I'm confusing her with another, I think that one of his daughters, for a while at least, was a recording artist, a singer in the music industry. And I think one of them is either painting or fashion. It is something to do with, you know, the cultural scene. But to be honest with you, I'd have to look that up to confirm. So don't take me to the back on that one.
No, that's fine. Another question came in. Oh yeah, we didn't quite get to this in this presentation, but he did, before his death, receive the Presidential Award. What is that award called? The Kennedy Center for the Arts?
He got Kennedy Center honors in 1995.
Okay.
And yes, he did the Presidential Award, the Medal of Freedom, I think it's called.
Right.
From President Obama. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the night that he got his honorary Oscar in 2001 was the same night that Denzel got his second Oscar win for the film Training Day, which was also the same night that Halle Berry became the first female Best Leading Actress winner.
Wow. Yeah. And then we just saw Will Smith obviously won for Best Actor the same night that they honored him in memoriam, right? Of course.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. But of course, Will Smith's is a little controversial now.
Yeah, that's
for other reasons.
Yeah, that's a story for for a different presentation. But I can say that Denzel has Sidney Poitier, still does have Sidney Poitier. He says, "We all stand on your shoulders." And
yeah.
Chadwick Boseman said the same thing to Denzel.
He said, go ahead, sorry.
Chadwick Boseman said there would be no Black Panther if it weren't for Denzel Washington. And Denzel Washington said there would be no Denzel Washington if it weren't for Sidney Poitier. So a lot of mutual respect.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's gotta be, it must be, I can't imagine how tough it is. And then in Sidney Poitier's speech, the specific names that he mentions, are those all African-American actors?
No, those are more studio executives, colleagues, people like that. Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. I don't have any other. I was curious. What was his private life like outside of political and acting? I mean, him and his wife had just a normal. I guess again, they probably didn't gossip as much back then.
Yeah. No. He and his wife had. They certainly had their difficulties. And what I did leave out for the sake of time. He became involved while he was still married. He became involved with Diane Carroll, and he was very much in love with Diane Carroll. But he also his wife did not want to divorce him because she did not want to give him, as she put it, an easy out. So she did not want to divorce. He was involved with Diane Carroll, very much in love with her, and she with him. Diane Carroll was also married. And they actually had plans to meet up and to move in together, that each of them would leave their respective homes and they would begin a new life together. And he was all set to go, but she stood him up. Something that he was not able really to, I don't want to say that he wasn't able to forgive her for, but it was definitely something he never got over. And what made it awkward was that this was all before they did a movie together where they played love interests.
Oh, wow. The movie,
I did not mention that movie. It's called Paris Blues. It's from 1961, and it's phenomenal. Paul Newman, Joanne Woodward, Poitier, and Diane Carroll. I mean, talk about a killer cast. So he and Paul Newman played jazz musicians living in Paris. It's the beatnik era, the beatnik scene. They're playing in this jazz club. It's a Duke Ellington score. Louis Gossett Jr. Louis Armstrong. Louis Armstrong has a supporting role in the film. And it's daring for its time. It's the beatnik scene. So scenes of drug abuse and themes of racism and that kind of thing. And so Joanne Woodward and Diane Carroll play best friends who are traveling. They're on holiday in Paris together. And they all meet each other. And then you have two love stories going. You know, Paul Newman and Joanne Woodward hooked up, and Poitier and Diane Carroll. And the filming of the movie, I can't even imagine what that must have been like, because she pretty much had moved on and he was still holding the torch for her.
Oh, and my gosh.
With the knowledge that she stood him up when they were supposed to be leaving. So his personal life was not without its difficulties.
Right.
Eventually, he and his wife did divorce, and in the 1970s, he had a child, another daughter, with someone he eventually married, and she was the woman that he was still married to at the time of his death.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah, but I mean, no one's without their own personal difficulties, right? And all the more reason to dive into some of those biographies that you mentioned too. Is there any chance that you'd be able to send me that list so I can share it with everybody in case they want it? Okay, that would be great.
The works cited slide, you mean? Yes, absolutely. Yes.
Yeah. Because I want to just make sure that everybody has a chance to go through, because obviously there's way more than just what's in this presentation, but it was still a lot of information and really great career. And we really appreciate you coming online with us tonight.
Thank you for having me.
And, Debbie did have one more question. Was it expected that he would win for Lilies, or was it a surprise?
The truth is, I think it depends on whom you asked. I think it would depend on whom you asked at the time. I mean, the film was released in 63, so this would have been early 64 at the time of the awards ceremony. So, the March on Washington had happened. I do know that there was some concern that his involvement in that would have, there was concern that the fact that he was involved in the March on Washington would have a negative impact on his Oscar chances, because people would see him as making trouble, crusader, that kind of thing. He chose to match anyway. Obviously, it did not hurt his Oscar chances, but there was, so again, I think it depends on whom you asked in the Academy as far as whether or not this was something that people saw coming. Yeah, is it time, or, has his, political involvement, however, I don't want to say isolated, but this one rather historic, but this one event, as opposed to a career's worth of being vocal, did he shoot himself in the foot? Cynics would say. So I think a lot of people saw it going both ways. I know that Paul Newman was, at this point, this would have been Paul Newman's third nomination. He was nominated for Cat in a Hot Tin Roof and The Hustler. And now this was a third nomination for the film Hud. So I think there were some who were expecting that Paul Newman would get it, particularly since his wife, Joanne Woodward, was already an award winner for Three Faces of Eve. So let's crown Hollywood's golden couple with one Oscar each. So I think, but there were some, I think, who were thinking Paul Newman would find his name in the envelope. But as far as Poitier himself, he said he knew that this was, as he put it, "I knew I was a one-man show," he said, that this was not, he didn't think, he was not expecting that this was opening up any doors.
Interesting. Well, that was great. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. And I hope we can have you back again for one of your many other presentations. You have such a vast knowledge of film. It's great. Definitely check out Frank's podcast, Silver Screeners. He's got a lot of different episodes about Oscars past leading up to the last Oscars, and he's still producing new episodes, of course. Thank you very much for joining us, and I'll email out this recording tomorrow. Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you very much. I'll send you the list too. Thank you all for coming. Awesome.